Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your patience in holding. We now have your speakers in conference. Participation in this conference call is by express written invitation of the AHA only. Unauthorized participants and or any party that aids and abets such unauthorized participants may be subject to criminal and civil penalties under both state and federal law. Please disconnect from the call or log off the webinar if the AHA does not expressly invite your participation. It is now my pleasure to turn today's event over to Jonathan McKinney. Please go ahead, sir.
Hello, I'm Jonathan McKinney from the American Hospital Association and the Institute for Diversity and Health Equity. Thank you for joining us today for this timely webinar where we will be discussing how hospitals and health systems can advance racial equity to create business value. This webinar will provide research, insights, and practical examples of how hospitals and health systems are moving to action. With that, let me introduce our presenters for today. Kate Summerfield is the president of the National Social Determinants of Health Institute at ProMedica, a mission-driven, not-for-profit healthcare and well-being system based in Toledo, Ohio. ProMedica is the 15th largest hospital system in the country, serving communities in 28 states, and is an industry leader in the social determinants of health. Under Kate's leadership, the National Social Determinants of Health Institute is driving clinical integration of social determinants of health through patient screening, connecting those patients to a variety of interventions like food clinics and community health workers, and launched a $50 million place-based neighborhood revitalization effort that includes a nonprofit grocery store in a former food desert. Most recently, the National Social Determinants of Health Institute has launched an employer solution for employee screening and intervention. Prior to joining ProMedica, Kate worked for various community-based and nonprofit organizations, including the United Way system, leading both rural and urban change. Our next presenter for today is Ryan D'Souza. Ryan is an associate director at FSG, a nonprofit consulting firm working to promote equitable social change. At FSG, Ryan partners with the nation's leading corporations and foundations to advance health equity. He is the co-author of Healthcare and the Competitive Advantage of Racial Equity, How Advancing Racial Equity Can Create Business Value, which was published in April 2019. Prior to joining FSG, Ryan launched and managed a consulting service at the Association of American Medical Colleges and advised hospitals and health systems on how to improve operational and financial performance while at the advisory board company. Please welcome Kate and Ryan.
Great. Well, thank you for the introduction, Jonathan, and welcome everyone. Thank you for viewing this webinar. Although we're not live with you today, we're eager to share our insights and experiences and to connect with you afterwards, should you have any questions or comments. Before we dive in, I just want to give you a bit of the lay of the land or a roadmap for how we want to use our time today. I'm going to kick things off by giving you a grounding in the root causes of inequities that fall along the lines of race and ethnicity, fundamentally why we see these inequities. And then also give you an overview of the research we did here at FSG in partnership with our colleagues at PolicyLink to explore how healthcare organizations are beginning to move to action in light of these inequities. From there, I'm going to turn it over to Kate, who will talk about the pioneering work at ProMedica and the ongoing journey that they're on. We're hoping that you walk away from today's webinar with a deeper appreciation of the root causes behind racial health inequities, the social and business imperative to do something about it, and some practical ideas and lessons learned from leading organizations, recognizing that both ProMedica and the organizations that FSG profiled are on a journey, that no one has solved this yet or has all the right answers, and that there's a tremendous amount of humility that is brought to this work. So with all that said, I think a good place to start is in the data, and it's to have a shared understanding of the data, and much of these data should look pretty familiar to you. They point to a number of inequitable outcomes in health for people of color, from hypertension to breast cancer, to diabetes, and even care delivery, showing up in lower quality care. And I want to underscore that this is not simply a matter of income or education or socioeconomic status. Really, one of the seminal studies of the last decade helped really shape our understanding of this by showing that Black people with high amounts of educational attainment still experience lower life expectancy than their peers with less education. And even recent research, just published this last month, points to the persistence of inequity, that there's an opportunity gap that appears in adulthood between Black and white children born to parents at the same income level, which also corresponds to gaps in mortality. So in other words, at the end of the day, education and the rising income that comes with that education are not protective against experiencing poor health outcomes for people of color. I think a simple but important question that folks ask when presented with this kind of data is why. If these inequities are persistent and can't be explained away by socioeconomic status, then what's behind these numbers? And we can start to see that in this next slide. That over the past 5 to 10 years, hospitals and health systems, like many of you viewing this webinar today, health plans, and even biopharma, and others responsible for delivering and managing care, have acknowledged and embraced decades of research from epidemiology and the sociology of medicine, that health is more than just care, it's about conditions. It's about the conditions where people live that ultimately influence their ability to be healthy. And you can see this reflected on the next slide here in the growth of interventions that seek to go outside of the walls of the clinic to address the social risk factors in the environment where people live. This is important and necessary work. And while these social determinants of health are important, they don't fully explain how the health of individuals and populations is shaped and why there are differences in health along racial lines. And in fact, the disproportionate impact of COVID-19 on communities of color and the ongoing movement for Black lives are helping to put into the forefront what the last 20 plus years of research has attempted to show, that there are deeper structural factors at play. And that key structural factor is structural racism. So structural racism, as just a quick recap, refers to the public policies, the institutional practices, and the cultural representations that oftentimes work in interacting and reinforcing ways that ultimately foster racial discrimination, that lead to an unfair and unjust distribution of resources, and ultimately raise the risk of poor health in communities of color. And this structural determinant of health ultimately shapes these social conditions that you're seeing here on your screen. And they directly influence the health of individuals and the care that they receive. So racism is the root cause of racial health inequities. So let me try to make this more concrete. So, you know, poor health outcomes and the associations with poverty are readily apparent above the surface, right? We talked about that just a couple minutes ago. But it's just the tip of the iceberg. When we start to look beneath the surface, we begin to see the drivers, the real causes. We see the federally legalized practice of denying home loans to Black families and the restrictive rules preventing Black families from living in predominantly white neighborhoods. We see the combined impact with ongoing housing discrimination where the racial makeup of neighborhoods across the country don't look very different from what they looked like 100 years ago. We live in a highly segregated society. And ultimately, we see a connection and a concentration of health-harming conditions in neighborhoods of color with health-enhancing conditions in those predominantly white neighborhoods as a function of this structural racism that's been happening historically and ongoing. So there's clearly a social imperative to act, but there's also a business imperative. And You know, we can start to see that when we look at the changing demographics in our country. You know, people of color will be the majority in this country by 2050. In fact, this is rapidly becoming the reality in certain parts of the country already. So this became the genesis for our research here at FSG in collaboration with our partner, PolicyLink, who has been and continues to be a national leader on advancing racial and economic equity. We observed a gap in the literature in naming structural racism as a root cause and an opportunity to build awareness around how healthcare organizations are making sense of structural racism and beginning to move to action. And in our report, which is the culmination of about a year of research that we published last year, we profile leading integrated health systems and commercial insurance companies that have begun to anchor their health equity agenda to advancing racial equity. And I want to just give you a quick overview of that research across the next couple of slides here. And there are really two reinforcing strategies that these organizations were undertaking. They are redesigning the way they provide core services. So many of these might look familiar to you, and you might be already starting to take on some of these. You know, we can't advance racial equity without having a deep understanding and a disaggregation of the data. There's a recognition and understanding of the social factors that drive health outside of clinical factors. There's an embedding of cultural humility and a real appreciation for the role that structural racism plays in shaping clinical quality and how that understanding helps to guide engagement with patients, and then ultimately expanding outside of the four walls of the clinic. But the health systems that we profiled, and in a second I'm going to turn it over to Kate, is that they're not just stopping there. It's a reinforcing strategy, and that the health systems we profiled are also engaging in the second strategy of improving the underlying conditions in communities by changing public policy, strengthening economic vitality in ways that begin to combat structural racism. And what really distinguishes the work of all of the organizations that we profiled with respect to these strategies is that they fundamentally recognize that place and race matter to promoting health equity, that health equity depends on racial equity. And this also shows up in a set of internal catalysts that are enabling and driving these strategies. And this was actually my favorite part of the research, is really understanding what makes these hospitals and health systems tick. And really this commitment to place and race is reflected in their organizational culture. It's reflected in strong diversity and inclusion practices. It's in leadership support and accountability that begins at the very top and flows throughout the organization. And it's also reflected in innovative cross-sector partnerships, recognizing that no one organization can advance racial equity on its own. It takes really thoughtful, patient partnership and humility to move this work forward. So from a business perspective, you know, these organizations are not only poised to advance racial equity, but they're also poised to enhance business performance by delivering on the triple aim objectives of better population health, better experience of care, and lower costs. And ultimately, this stands in contrast to many interventions to advance health equity that don't intentionally acknowledge racial equity as a critical success factor. So with that being said, I'm really eager now to turn the conversation over to Kate to talk about ProMedica's journey and how they are thinking about this space and how they are moving to action. Kate, I'll go ahead and turn it over to you.
Well, thank you so much, Ryan and FSG, Jonathan, AHA, and the Institute for Diversity and Health Equity. So appreciate the partnership and the opportunity to talk and share a little bit about the work we're doing at ProMedica. I guess I just to start would echo what Ryan said. You know, certainly I think both from a healthcare perspective, but also organizationally, really come to this conversation with a level of humility. And I think while, you know, at ProMedica, we're going to talk about some of the work we're doing, some of the lessons learned, really the tangible action steps that health systems can take, I think it's simply also not enough, right? And so I think we have to come to this conversation first from acknowledging now is the time for both healthcare and organizations to really take a hard look at how we're embedding equity, how we're investing to really make sure that race is being addressed. And so I just want to kind of as we jump into the conversation, first say that. So for a little bit of context, just about ProMedica, you may be familiar with our system. We are based in Toledo, Ohio, so it is home for us. So I'm talking to you today from Toledo in a cold, rainy day, just south of the Detroit and Michigan border. But as an organization, just for context, as it relates to maybe your own organization, we are a $7 billion health system. We have 13 hospitals that span both Ohio and Michigan. And then recently we acquired about 2 years ago, a company, HCR ManorCare, that had just over 400 post-acute facilities in about 30 states. We also have an insurance plan that has a commercial Medicaid and Medicare product, and then we employ a group of physicians and clinicians as well. So that's just some context maybe around our organization. I think one of the questions we get often is, okay, so you know, you're investing significantly in this work. How do you do it, and how do you make the case? And so just some context about our organization. About 10 years ago, we started to also really think about our work relative to the social determinants, and today I'm going to talk about our journey there, but really taking on social determinants as fundamentally part of our core mission. And so our journey was a long, winding path over the last 10 years, and so I guess that what I would say, in addition to coming to this conversation with humility, is also that it is truly a journey, right? Where we were a year ago or 10 years ago certainly is continuing to advance. And organizationally, we really started first from the community health needs assessment. So we, every nonprofit organization is required per the IRS and the 990 to do both a community health needs assessment and an implementation plan. And so that's where we started. It was really a conversation that we had with both our public schools and students in our public school settings. And it was around 08, 09 when the economy was really taking a downturn. And we went into the schools. It was when the issue of childhood obesity was really the hot button issue. Many of you might have heard us share this story. And very quickly, as we started to engage with students, with teachers, with parents, and school nurses, very quickly heard, you know, obesity certainly, you know, is a symptom, but the root cause at the time really was around hunger. And so it caused us to start to think about hunger as a health issue. I think from the learning I would just share, and certainly from Ryan's comments, we know the disproportionate impact around that race plays on hunger. And so continuing to challenge how we think about that and how we truly address the root causes. But really started from that community health needs assessment process and starting to think about hunger as a health issue. We started to screen our patient population for food insecurity and start to address some of those issues. And as we continued on the journey, a couple of things happened for us. One, we started to understand the impact from a business perspective. Obviously, it's the right thing to do from a mission perspective, but it also started to really point to the return on investment. Again, from a business model, how addressing social and economic issues really made folks healthier, started to address some of the root causes, but ultimately started to improve things like cost and utilization. And so that was the first really big aha for us to say, okay, by changing our care delivery model, starting to address social and economic factors, this can really not only be the right thing to do, but also make incredibly strong business sense in what the Ryan and the folks at FSG have pointed to in their analysis. In addition, it started to really challenge us to think more deeply. Hunger is such a tangible thing to be able to, you know, you can physically hand folks food, but to be able to address more systemic issues like things around housing policy and living wage and preschool and things that we'll talk about in a little bit. But it also started this really journey for us to think about our mission and why we existed as an organization. And this question around impact started to happen, both at the board level, but also from our executive C-suite. If we were a nonprofit mission-based health system, what is the impact that we're trying to drive? And on the right, you can see, you know, typical metrics. Many hospitals and healthcare organizations track things like days cash on hand and market share and revenue. But if our impact is around the health of our communities, if we truly are a nonprofit mission-based system, those things on the right that traditional healthcare measures simply aren't enough, right? It's about the health and well-being of the communities we serve. And it was really this fundamental shift in both our strategy, but also how we made investment that started to challenge why and what we're doing and where we're investing those dollars. And certainly, I think a continued journey as we work to deepen this space as well. And so just from a context perspective, we're going to start to shift into the actual what, right? A lot of questions we get from healthcare leaders is, okay, this is great. Yep, I'm on board. But what do you actually do, right? What's the first step and what are some very practical approaches? And so I love this graphic. This actually comes from the Bay Area Regional Health Inequities Initiative doing just fantastic work in the Bay Area. So a huge shout out to our friends there. I think this graphic really describes and starts to articulate the upstream and the downstream work. And on the right-hand side, you can see the downstream, the things that both Ryan and Jonathan mentioned that healthcare is usually focused on, you know, what happens inside our four walls and our hospitals and our practices, you know, thinking about and working on chronic conditions and disease and health risk behaviors on that right. And this is where healthcare, both from a provider perspective, but also from a payer perspective, really historically have lived. And then as you move to the left, you start to see living conditions. So things like housing and employment, and you start to see social environment and conditions and how is healthcare, we can start to address that both from policy and investments. And then finally, I think Ryan did a fantastic job in articulating this growing recognition, but also the push to deepen the work, institutional inequities, both from a healthcare perspective. So internally, what are the policies, practices that we have internally that are contributing to inequity, but also some of the social inequities as well. And so I think this is just a great framework to think about, you know, where are you as an organization? Where are you in this journey? Where are your investments? And what are the things that you're doing today? And a continued diagram and that we continue to really look at and check our work against. So practically, you know, we talked about upstream and downstream. I want to get to some very tactical things that we did that hopefully help spark some opportunity for you. So we think about interventions in two different buckets. So one at an individual level or social needs. So things like food clinics. So we're going to talk a little bit about some of this work in more depth. But understanding and identifying individual social needs. So things like hunger or the need for housing assistance, early childhood or implicit bias training. These are interventions that can be deployed, again, at the individual, more a micro level to address some social needs. But also, as we went to more of the left, on the left hand of the previous slide, the population level, policy systems, environmental change that we can drive that have more systemic and long-term change. Things like predatory lending or supporting living wage that you can do within your health system, but also across the communities you serve. And then finally getting into some more of the anchor institution strategies like supplier diversity spend as an example. So we really start to think about our interventions in these two areas, and I'm going to highlight a few of the things that we're doing to give some context. So the first thing and really the most community-facing thing that we did when we first started this journey was actually launch the eBide Center. And so in 2015, we received, in partnership with the eBide Family Foundation, we received some support to actually open up a grocery store in what was a previously a food desert. And this started from a series of conversations with neighborhood leaders and stakeholders to really talk about the needs and understand more deeply the needs that our low to moderate income and predominantly minority communities and neighborhoods were facing. And very clearly, the need around grocery access became a theme in those conversations. We previously had a grocery store that was located in the downtown central core. It was a large chain and had closed down. And so we opened up and decided in partnership and out of a lot of conversation with community leaders and stakeholders to open up a grocery store that today we own and operate and support. In addition, we have a lot of wraparound services that are offered in the grocery store. So everybody that works in the grocery store is from the neighborhood, all a lot of different stories and backgrounds, but ultimately really trying to create a stronger pipeline into our health system. You know, one of the very first stories I'll never forget as we were opening in 2015 we started to do some employment work, and one of the things that became very clear to us early on is that we had to start to challenge and think differently about our internal policies. So as folks, like many of you probably, as folks become employees of our organization, we require direct deposit, right? A very simple thing that we require, and we hand folks a form and say, yep, put your bank account here. And it was through the work in the eBide Center and the Market on the Green that we started to really check some of the policies that we have. Lots of folks, for a variety of reasons, don't have bank accounts or banking access. And here was a policy that was on our books that we honestly just took for granted, didn't even think about the barriers to employment. And so we were able to partner with our internal credit union, work around that, actually change those policies, provide folks with a paper check, come in with our credit union and a bank on program, and support and allow for folks to have banking supports that really long-term, again, eliminated one barrier. So that's one example. There's a litany of different things that really learning lessons and that spirit of humility that really started to connect us on this journey. In addition to the grocery store, and we provide support for local businesses, lots of local produce and vendors, we also have on the second floor a teaching kitchen where we're providing folks opportunities, you know, things and programs like how to feed a family of four for under $10. We have a financial opportunity center that I'll talk about in a little bit, but provides free financial coaching, part of the LISC model across the country that does free financial coaching. We do taxes, benefits, supports, really providing for the financial stability of our patients, members, employees, and community. And then in addition, we have some workforce programs. One of the areas for us that was incredibly need in terms of internal supports was around STNA, state-tested nursing assistants, if you're in the state of Ohio. And so this is the entry-level nursing positions in both acute and post-acute. We had a lot of job opportunities. On any given day, we have about 100 individuals that we have positions that are actually vacant, so about 100 vacant positions across our community. And yet we know for the neighborhoods that we're serving with the eBide Center and some of our other programs, employment and unemployment and underemployment continues to be a huge need. And so we're able to provide on-site training and support and work with our HR team to eliminate those barriers. So the eBide Center is just one example of one of the things that we were able to launch, again, a level of humility and cultural competence and learning as we continue to implement this program. As we started to then work and really think about, okay, great, we did a grocery store, we have some programming, but how do we make sure that the same level of investment that Toledo has invested in our core business district, how as a community and certainly how as a health system do we begin to make that same investment in the neighborhoods that surround our community and our downtown core business district? We decided in partnership again with the eBide family to make a $50 million 10-year commitment to invest in the neighborhoods that surround. And this was really important for us for a variety of reasons. One, it started to signal the commitment that we have and that we have around health equity, that it's not only grocery access, but also addressing things like redlining and stable housing and investing in a healthy, affordable housing, education, and health in a much deeper way. And so it's one thing to talk about this work, and it's a whole other thing to make a pretty significant commitment to this work and to do it in partnership with other organizations. So in addition to the grocery store work that we did, we also made a $50 million commitment to really focus on place and understanding that both place and race matter to health. And so in addition to providing additional support around housing, rolling out universal preschool program across the city, focusing on workforce development, we also knew that the physical infrastructure of the neighborhoods that we served were incredibly important to address. So you can have all the programming, all the housing and the financial coaching and the cooking classes, but if you're not addressing things and like dilapidated housing, lack of disinvestment in housing or vacant lots or lack of small businesses, especially focused on women minority-owned businesses, that ultimately you weren't going to change and aren't going to change the trajectory of the neighborhood. So we, in partnership with LISC, created a $25 million loan pool to actually invest in both real estate, small businesses, and mixed-use property, again with an eye towards equity supporting women and minority-owned businesses in the same neighborhood that we have the grocery store, and we're building actually mixed-income housing as well. And so it really was, again, this learning journey to make sure that as an organization we were focused on equity, that we were thinking about that in terms of the investments that we were making, but that we are also engaging community in a deeper way. And so this is really where partnership comes in, where you have to figure out who has trust in the neighborhood. And Ryan and I talk a lot about this notion that change only happens at the speed of trust, and that we have to, as healthcare organizations, ensure that we're listening, but that we're also partnering with the organizations that are trusted and that we're building that trust over time. So this is one example of a population health and where we invested both to address social needs, but we're also addressing more systemic change as well. One additional example, we get lots of questions around the food clinic program that we're running. So in addition to our external community-facing work, we also started to screen for a variety of different social and economic needs. And so we screen across 13 different domains today. So we're asking patients around hunger and food, workforce development, domestic violence, transportation. And as patients are identifying having social need issues, we're working to connect those individuals to different interventions. One example of this is the food prescription program, and there are a handful of really great programs like this around the country where we're actually prescribing food as medicine. And I think from a business case, one of the things that has been incredibly powerful is in addition to engaging individuals and writing prescriptions, asking different questions, being able to support those patients with food access, connecting to different resources. But not only doing that in a way that's improving health, but also starting to see some cost reduction. And so around the business imperative, you know, how do you go to your CFO and make the case for some of this work? I want to show a couple of different examples of how we've been able to do this. So this example is around the food clinic. And again, this is identifying patients in the primary care setting that have screened positive for food insecurity, have actually said, yep, I'm struggling or my household is struggling around food insecurity, connecting them with a resource. And we see about an 18% reduction in ED costs, reductions in readmissions, and actually increases in primary care as well. And so one of the questions we get was, well, how do you make the business case? You know, how do you get buy-in internally, maybe from your C-suite who might be skeptical, starting to show examples like this, hard numbers. And then as you implement different programs, tracking that data over time is incredibly important as well. So again, right thing to do, but also makes really strong business case. One additional example I want to just share with the folks today is around the Hope College Promise. And so in February, pre-COVID, we actually, in partnership with the Cadence Family Foundation, launched the Hope College Promise. And this provided opportunity, free room, tuition, and board to all graduating seniors at Scott High School. Scott is a Central City high school, predominantly African American, really the heartbeat of the Black community in the Toledo area. And we partnered to provide free room, tuition, and board not only to those students, but also it was a two-generational approach and provided support to their parent legal guardian as well. And so just some incredible examples of things that you can do from a healthcare perspective. We 120 seniors graduate this fall. About 65, 68 of them are actually on track to go to the schools that you see listed here, including Central State, University of Toledo, BGSU, and some community colleges as well. And so one example around how you can incorporate equity, the fact that the promise was the first high school was Scott High School, really being intentional around how we make investments, again, with a lens that both race matter, but also that our investments have to line up around equity. And then the last example I just want to share with the group, and again, really look forward to engaging in some discussion here as well, is around the Financial Opportunity Center. So the Financial Opportunity Center, as I mentioned previously, is located above the grocery store. This is in partnership with the local initiative support corporation, LISC. There are a lot of other financial opportunity centers around the country and certainly other healthcare organizations doing this work. As we track that data, we see an impact on financial security. So about $400 average increase in monthly income, increasing in credit score. But we've also been able to match that data as it relates to ED and inpatient visits as well. And you can see the cost reduction and improvement as well. And so this Financial Opportunity Center is one example of where, as an organization and an industry, we needed to really start to scale. And we're really focused on making sure that the interventions that are provided across the country in social determinants not only are measuring the right things and showing the ROI and the data, but that we're also working to scale this work as well. So I wanted to, hopefully this was really helpful in terms of very tangible things. Want to just pause and turn it back over to Ryan and to Jonathan. Again, thank you for the opportunity to share some of the work. Really looking forward to discussing and diving in as well.
Great. Thank you, Kate and Ryan. This has certainly been a wonderful and very informative session today. I would like to thank you again, Kate Summerfield from ProMedica and Ryan D'Souza from FSG. Thank you again for sharing your experience with our audience. To stay connected and up to date on IFDHE's latest reports and webinars, please follow us on Twitter where you can find all of our information. We would also like to ask our viewing audience to take a moment to complete our webinar evaluation form. You will see a web link on your screen. However, to access the survey, please use the link located in the webinar description on the YouTube channel. You can also find a link to the survey on the description of this webinar on the IFDHE webinar website. We thank you, and we hope that you take this opportunity to evaluate the webinar and help us understand what's working well and what's most beneficial to you. Thank you again, and we hope that you enjoy the rest of your day.